Howdy all, and welcome to the next lesson on Invasion of the Body Snatchers. And we're going to be looking at the importance of conventions. Okay, so the learning objective is looking at how these genre conventions that you typically see in films are important and how they're used. And then next lesson we'll be looking at how that applies to Invasion of the Body Snatchers. Okay, so the start of activity then. Which genre do each of these films belong to, and how do you know? Pause the video and perhaps consider 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What are the genres for these films? Pause the video. Okay, so what you may have found then is that the first one, Australia, is likely to be a romantic film. You've got Misery, which you'd like to see as a horror film or a thriller. You've got Tomorrowland, which is likely to be a sci-fi film. And then you've got Moonlight, which is likely to be a drama, and you've got Blade, which is going to be an action film. Now, what's important though is to consider, how do you know based on these posters that these films belong to these genres? So in the Australia one, you've got the two characters embracing each other. In Misery, you've got the creepy colours and the isolated location and that face. In Tomorrowland, you've got the sense of wonder in her facial expression. And you've also got the sci-fi background, the backdrop. In the Moonlight poster, you've got the look on his face, that expressionless, kind of vacant look that he's got. Is typical of drama films, and the colours are very, very serious and intense. In Blade, you've got the creepy background. You've got the person at the front dressed in a bulletproof or stab-proof vest. So you can kind of tell that these films belong to the genre in which they're looking at. Out of these, I do recommend Moonlight is a great film, particularly how it explores homosexuality in America in a black community. I also recommend Australia because that's a really good drama and romantic film. So we're going to be looking at how these conventions are important and why they are used in the way that they are. Okay, so let's think about Scream then. I won't be clicking through on these links, but I will send you the PowerPoint so that you can click them through. I don't really want the horror stuff kind of included in the videos so that I don't get, kicked off YouTube for having violence and death. Okay, but I will send you the PowerPoint that you can click through the links so you can see these videos yourself. So what I want you to do then is I want you to look at the trailer, which is this one here, and I want you to look at the poster and tell me what genre you expect the film to be. Okay, so pause the video, go watch that trailer and look at the poster. What genre do you think it is? Okay, so you should be able to tell that this is a horror film based on the creepiness and the fact that you've got Drew Barrymore's character being phoned, and it's really creepy. Now, this second clip I want you to watch then is just a clip from the film, and what I want you to think to yourself is, does this film meet your expectations, and in what way does it, and in what way does it not? Okay, pause the video, watch the second clip, and how does it meet or go against your own expectations? Okay, so in the way that it does meet the expectations, it is a horror and someone dies and it's quite gratuitous and over the top with violence. However, what you might have also found is that the comedy element of it, particularly in that scene before the character goes off and dies, is something you might not have expected from the trailer. So it does kind of go against your expectations. Now, this film is famous for having misled their audience, which is what we're going to look at now. So the question is, based on the trailer, who would you expect the main actor or actress to be? Well, hopefully you'll have thought that Drew Barrymore's character would have been the main character. However, if you click this link here, this third link, you will discover that she dies in the very first scene. Okay, watch that clip and then carry on. Okay, so Drew Barrymore dying in that very first scene goes against the expectations of what the audience wanted. Now, what was it in the poster, in the trailer, that made us think that she was the main character? Well, you've got her front and centre. You've also got the phone call being made in the trailer. Okay, so the film poster and the trailer both set up that Drew Barrymore is going to be the main character. So the question is, why might her dying in that very first scene be something that audience might be disappointed by? So hopefully what you've come up with is that because of her star power at the time, she was a very famous actress, people would have been expecting her to be the main character and expecting her to live till the end, perhaps because they wanted to watch the film because of her. So instead, the filmmakers and the director called Wes Craven, he wanted the audience to be going in there with certain expectations and going against them. I do recommend the film if you get a chance to watch it. It's a really good example of how to go against audience expectations. Okay, this lesson is going to be very clip heavy, which we'll be sending through to links. But it's important that you understand how these conventions work then. Okay, now this is a whole chunk of writing which I'll read out to you in just a second. You can skip over that if you want, but you have to read it or listen to me read it. Okay, so the importance of conventions and expectations in film. Formal expectations and conventions really talk about the idea that film does not exist in a bubble. There are aspects of real life and aspects of film as an art form that shape the way in which the audience experiences a single film. Expectations are created by patterns within a single film. Think of the film Inception. Every time Leonardo DiCaprio spins that top, it either falls or spins forever. An expectation is created through the repetition of the image, and so when in the end, the top is spun for the last time and the audience expects something to happen, but it doesn't, thus defying the expectation created in the film and giving the film some of its allure to the audiences. Expectations can be across film as a whole, like audiences expect a happily ending from the film Tangled because every Disney princess movie has a happy ending, but this is when all expectations turn into conventions. Conventions are also extremely important to film form because they are common traits used across film as an art form. The filmmaker has to use conventions to show part of the plot without having it explicitly told to the audience. Viewers then are so accustomed to this technique that they don't need to question the time of day, they just understood. I think that expectations and conventions are things that we critical viewers should really pay attention to. A film can be judged on its own use and manipulation of expectations and conventions. Films can reference one another, pay homage to conventions, but modern filmmakers should be searching to find ways to create new conventions and or break conventions to change the way an audience feels during / about a film. Think about films that you've seen recently. What conventions did you see? Were they broken? And how did this change your experience? So what I wanted to do is kind of make notes from what this person has said about conventions. So why are they important? Okay, so make a note. Why do you think these conventions that are included in certain films are important to them? Think about the example that they chose from Tangled. Why do we need that happy ending? Think about the audience that's involved. Okay, make a note of why conventions are important in film. Okay, so if you struggle to get a clear answer written down there, my answer is, wait, I'll come back to that, they're just shortcuts. Okay, they're shortcuts, so you haven't got to spoon feed the audience who is who, what's going on, where are we, etc. If you overlook a city skyline in a film, that is to give you a sense of where we are and what's happening. Okay, so they're just shortcuts. Okay, so conventions are shortcuts that are created in a certain genre to set the audience up for certain expectations. Okay, now if you look at a film like Mamma Mia, so I want you to watch the trailer and then I want you to watch the clip, okay? Now, what expectations are you given based on that trailer? And then when you watch the clip, does the film match your expectations? Pause the video, watch the two clips, and come back to me. Okay, now, this is a clear example of a film just meeting your expectations. You went to watch a film, you saw it was going to be a musical in the trailer, you had certain love interest, you had certain comedy, and in the clip, you get that as well. So this film completely matches the audience expectations, okay? Hence the reason why they are just shortcuts. You don't want to go to a film where you've been set up with certain expectations. Perhaps you want to go with a certain relative or a certain partner, knowing that they might like the film, and then the film completely screws you over by not having the tropes and the expectations and the conventions that you typically expect of that genre. Now, in sci-fi, you expect certain things, okay? You expect aliens, you expect advanced technology, and something fantastical but believable, okay? So when you watch a trailer or see a poster, it is there to engage the people who like that genre. There is no point you setting up expectations for an audience just for you to disappoint them in the end, okay? Unless you're doing the DC universe and you want to disappoint people again and again with Harley Quinn or Suicide Squad or Batman v Superman, all those very disappointing, but pretty good trailers, okay? But in general, most film trailers are there to set your expectations so that when you go to see the film, you're not disappointed, okay? Now, what I do want you to watch, though, is this. This YouTube, they do it with lots of films, this YouTube channel does, but what it does is it changes the genre of the chosen film. So what I want you to do is click through that link and go to these sections here, okay? 235, 858, and 1020, okay? And what I'd like you to do is look at what genres Infinity War can be like meshed into, okay? So pause the video, watch this. It's really interesting to watch, actually, how it changes the genre, okay? So pause the video and go to these sections, 235, 858, I think it's a little bit longer than that, and then and then 1020. So what genres does the film the YouTube channel put it into, and how does it do that? Okay, pause the video and come back. Okay then, so what you should have come up with then is that the way it does it is through the music. It's where the cinematography and the editing is really slowed down. It clips certain elements so you get certain patches of dialogue that are used on purpose to make it seem a certain way. If you think about the romantic one, where it's all about making it look like a beautiful love story with the music, and you get characters talking about how much they love each other, etc. It really highlights how you can edit a film into a different genre by those expectations and conventions. Okay, with the Suicide one, it chooses the slow music. It's got the dialogue over the front, you've got the text over the black screen to give a sense of what the film's going to be about. So these conventions that are used are there to kind of manipulate you into watching the film and going in with certain expectations. Okay, let's move on. So sometimes they go against your expectations, like for example with Spider-Man. I'm actually going to click this one just for the giggles. Okay.
Oh, this is so cool. I have never been to a jazz club before.
Find us some shade. Thanks, Aunt Max.
Right this way, sir.
Isn't that your old girlfriend?
Yeah.
Do you want to go someplace else?
No, I'll be okay.
Mary Jane, show us what you got.
Peter?
This is for you.
Double time!
The idea. So Spider-Man 3, that is a Spider-Man film with a thrust and a click of the fingers and a musical number where a character dances on tables and slides on chairs. So that is negating or going against expectations and conventions badly. You expect certain things from a Spider-Man film. You do not expect to have a character thrusting while clicking in a Spider-Man film. but they do it anyway. And Spider-Man 3 has been universally mocked over the years, particularly for these sorts of scenes and the part where he flicks his hair, kind of like an emo kid, okay? So, sometimes they do it in a good way. Now, watch the trailer for Drive, okay? And what I want you to think to yourself is, what is the genre and what does it do to achieve that genre, okay? So pause the video, watch that clip, and what is the genre that's being put forward by the trailer, and how is that achieved? Okay, so the cinematography, you've got the fast editing, you've got the loud music, and you've got the violence, and the certain dialogue that's chosen puts it into the action genre, doesn't it? Okay, so Drive looks good from the trailer. However, when you actually come to watch the film, you will realise that this film is not what you expect it to be. So when you watch that next clip, what I want you to think to yourself is this the film that I expected when I watched that trailer? Okay, watch that clip and come back to me. Okay, so the trailer, action, violence, you can kind of get a sense of the intensity of it. However, you probably didn't expect the way that scene was going to go. You didn't expect the romance of it and how the lights kind of come down. It's quite it's very indie film with very like how do you call it, artistic choices in terms of how it's created. And the reason the director does that is because he's trying to put you in the mindset of the character a little bit more than your generic typical Hollywood film. But then when he beats the absolute living daylights out of that guy and stamps on his head, you don't expect that to happen. You don't expect the character to have that happen. In fact, you don't expect that to happen in the action film that's put into the trailer. It is going against your expectations and conventions on purpose. Okay? Now, the reason I'm bringing this up then is because we've talked about ways in which you've got typical expectations, like in Mamma Mia, typical expectations. You see a trailer, you get what you get what you paid for, and then you've got with Spider-Man, you go in expecting a Spider-Man film, and then you get a silly mess. But then in Drive, you expect to have action moments, and it does, but it takes it to such an extreme level because the conventions weren't there, okay? So my big question for this lesson then is, why do we have these conventions? Okay, have a think about that. Just give yourselves 30 seconds. Why do we have these conventions in films? Okay, so now that you've had a big think, I want you to answer this question. What is the importance of genres having conventions? Okay, and I've given you some keywords here: disappoint, expectations, shortcut, and conventions. Now, what you may have noticed over the last few lessons, we hadn't done a question 1B. We'd done a 1A and we'd done a 1C, and this one is 1B, and it should be the same every single time. Is what is the point of having genre conventions in a film? And remember, conventions just means typical things you might expect, okay? For example, in the Alien films, you expect to have aliens and you expect to have advanced technology. In romance, you expect to have love and passion and cheesy dialogue, okay? So what I want you to answer then is this question. What is the importance of genres having conventions? Why do we need them? Why are they necessary? And I want you to try to include these words, okay? Once you've finished, you can self-assess. Have you shown excellent knowledge and understanding of what conventions you use? It's really vague in terms of the mark scheme. But I want you to answer that question then. So what is the importance of genres having conventions? Okay. There's not really a right or wrong answer, but these key words here should help you come up with something good. Okay. All right. So pause the video. This is the final activity. I know it's been mostly just clip watching and me talking to you. But what I want you to do is tell me what is the importance of genres having conventions. You may want to refer back to this big chunk of text if you want to. Okay? So answer the question. This is the final activity. That's it. All right? Thank you, guys. See you in the next lesson.